You should have done that. We could have faced it together. People who make such allegations became victims of vicious personal attacks bordering on criminal defamation. This strategy of shooting the messenger will only alienate the international community further away from us. That is how I ended that letter. My sincere appeal, unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, did fall on deaf ears. And finally, today we are on the verge of being labelled as an international fugitive, and we face the risk of being hauled up before the ICC or the International Criminal Court. This would be a severe blow to the image of our country, which has a proud history of being a much loved and respected member of the international community. Mr. Speaker, for all those who don't know what the ICC treaty is, Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, as you know, became operational in 2002. And as of July 2009 last year, there were 110 countries who had become state parties to it. The ICC, based in The Hague in the Netherlands, has jurisdiction to prosecute individuals responsible for the most serious crimes of international concern, genocide, crimes against humanity, and the crimes of aggression and war crimes. However, the ICC has jurisdiction over any of these crimes only if the country is a state party or a signatory to the Rome Statute. Fortunately for the Rajapaksa family and for your government, Sri Lanka is not a signatory to this treaty because Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe in 2002 refused to be a signatory on the basis that Sri Lanka has the independent institutions able to undertake such investigation if and when the necessity arises. In fact, Honourable Rajapaksa, the Rajapaksa family and the Rajapaksa government owes a debt of gratitude to the much-aligned Ranil Wickremesinghe for his forward-thinking wisdom as Prime Minister. This matter, Mr. Honourable Rajapaksa, Ranil Wickremesinghe Mathumata, Botal Visikarano and M.A. Harriana Nandua, Lampua Patukala Vandino Udera, Etumarita, however, Mr. Speaker, the woes of this regime does not end there, because there is provision in the treaty for the UN Security Council to refer a non-state party to the ICC like they did to Ceylon. Sudan also non-signatory to the ICC in 2005. Sudan, Mr. Speaker, I urge, let the dancing monkeys dance for you, Honourable Rajapaksa. I urge you to listen to this bit. Sudan is a case study. Please study. I'm giving you, please study, get your official. Is a case study of interest to Sri Lanka in the present context. Subsequent to the refusal of the Sudanese government to cooperate with the UN to investigate allegations of war crimes and crimes against humanity, the United Nations Security Council passed Resolution 1593, referring, I quote, the situation prevailing in Darfur since 1st July 2002 to the prosecutor of the ICC. Now, this is the part they are taking now. That is why I'm warning you. Despite Sudan insisting that the court has no jurisdiction over the matter. Just like this, they got people to shout, they got people to go on protest marches in Darfur. The courts issued arrest warrants in 2007 for the Sudanese humanitarian affairs minister and a militia leader. And July 2008, Mr. Speaker, an arrest warrant was issued for President al-Bashir, making the first head of state to be indicted by the ICC. In spite of familiar and anti-Western rhetoric and staged protest in Darfur, Bashir President Bashir even today remains an international fugitive with an international warrant issued for his arrest. Other than to a few other African countries, he is unable to travel outside his country. Mr. Speaker, although I have many reservations about the leaders of this government, I would hate to see such a scenario being enacted in Sri Lanka. The ignominy of such a situation would be a devastating blow to our country and our people with devastating consequences for years to come. That is why the government, even at this late stage, must deal with this problem in a responsible manner to salvage the good name of our country, instead of resorting its village thug tactics and wishfully hoping that countries like China will bail us out of a difficult situation in the UN eventually. In this context, I would also please listen to this also. Keep it in mind. It is interesting to note that China did not use its veto power when the United Nations Secretary General the UN Security Council adopted Resolution 1593 against Sudan, referring Sudan to the ICC in March 2005. China abstained along with the United States, allowing the resolution to pass by 11 votes. This was in spite of the fact that China and Sudan have very warm and cordial diplomatic relations. Beijing's investment rose to $1.6 billion in 2005, Sudan the ninth largest recipient for Chinese FDI. And even recently, look, Iran is a very close ally of China, but China went and backed the US-backed resolution against Iran about its nuclear powers recently in the United Nations. So be practical, be pragmatic. Don't be daydreaming, thinking that various other people will come to save you at the when things are difficult, because it won't happen. Especially the government of China is a very practical and a pragmatic country, which always makes sure that it does not go against the more powerful bloc at critical moments, and that is the history of the United Nations, Mr. Speaker. If our country is referred to a war crimes prosecution, it will also tarnish the image of our armed forces. The Sri Lanka Army is one of the most disciplined armies in the world, and this was the main reason that our army was chosen for peacekeeping activities around the world by the United Nations in 2002. It's simply because Sri Lanka had a disciplined army, much respected by the world, that the United Nations thought that the Sri Lankan army was good enough to be part and parcel of the peacekeeping force. So, but as you know, exactly this, however, listen, even in the best of armies, there could be a few black sheep or miscreants who tarnish the image of the entire force by their actions. And many countries, not only Sri Lanka, protect the reputation of their respective armies by investigating any allegations and punishing those responsible in keeping with the law of the land. For example, everyone talks about the United States. Mr. Speaker, for example, I'll just take one example now because of the limited amount of time. In 2004, in the New Yorker magazine, in the United States, I'm sure Honorable Rajapaksa is well aware of that, a journalist called Seymour Hersh, along with a local TV station, related accounts of physical, psychological and sexual abuse, including torture and homicide of prisoners held in the Abu Ghraib prison in Iraq by personnel of the U.S. Army. This newspaper accused U.S. Army personnel of physical, psychological and sexual abuse of the most horrible kind. For example, Mr. Speaker, when those allegations were made, what did the U.S. government do? They did not label the journalist as an Al-Qaeda sympathizer, nor did they send white vans in search of this journalist. They did not bomb the TV station which announced this allegation. The Secretary of Defense in the United States, you know, unlike here, is a cabinet minister, did not use his position to threaten the media to stop them writing about these allegations. Instead, Mr. Speaker, the U.S. Department of Defense carried out a full-scale investigation and 11 soldiers were convicted to court between May 2004 and March 2005. 11 soldiers sentenced to military prison and dishonorably discharged from service. And now recently, London Times, I saw it last week, last Wednesday reported that Prime Minister David Cameron is to announce an inquiry into claims that British security services were complicit in the torture of terrorism suspects. This is how a government acts when there are such allegations. Even in Sri Lanka, previous governments have responded swiftly to allegations of state violence. In the face of mounting criticism and outrage at the rape and murder of 16-year-old Krishanthi Kumaraswamy in 1996, President Chandrika Kumaratunga ordered a trial at bar against the army personnel accused, while the forces personnel behind the floating Bolgada bodies in 1995 were also charged.